Hello everyone, today we are going to discuss about engine cooling systems. So objective of this session is to study different cooling systems used in internal combustion engines, and the outcome is the student will be able to explain different cooling systems used in internal combustion engines. Let's go through the points which are to be discussed, and these are: for engine cooling systems we are going to discuss need of the engine cooling system, characteristics of an efficient cooling system, then types of cooling systems, mainly liquid cooling system and air cooling system. So now, what is the need of cooling system? So we know that during the process of converting thermal energy to mechanical energy, high amount of heat energy is produced in the cylinder of the engine as a result of combustion process. A large portion of the heat from the gases of combustion is transferred to the cylinder head and walls of the cylinder, as well as to the piston and the inlet and exhaust walls. Unless this excess heat is carried away and these parts are adequately cooled, the engine will be damaged. The cooling of system must be provided not only to prevent damage to the vital parts of the engine, but the temperature of these components must be maintained within a certain limits to obtain maximum performance of the engine. A cooling system is needed to keep engine from not getting so hot as to cause the problems, and yet to permit it to run hot enough to ensure maximum efficiency of the engine. Okay, so the next point is the characteristics of efficient cooling system. Okay. So first characteristic is it should be capable of removing about 30% of the heat generated in the combustion chamber while maintaining the optimum temperature of the engine under all operating conditions of the engine. The next point is it should remove heat at a faster rate when engine is hot. And then last is, however, it during the starting of the engine, cooling should be minimum so that working parts of the engine reach their operating temperatures in short time. So we know that we need some amount of temperature of the parts so that they can work properly. So cooling system must be capable of removing heat about 30% of the total generated heat, and again it should work faster. Okay. The next point which I want to discuss is types of engine cooling systems. So there are two types of cooling systems based on which cooling medium is used inside the system, and those are the liquid cooling system, or it is also called as indirect cooling system, and the next one is the air cooling system, or also called as a direct cooling system. Let's discuss these systems in details. So first, that is liquid cooling systems. Okay, in this system mainly water is used and made to circulate through the jackets provided around the cylinder. Cylinder head, wall ports and seats, where it extracts most of the heat. It consists of a long flat thin walled tube with an opening facing the water pump outlet and a number of small openings along the length of the that direct the water against the walls and other components of the engine. Okay. So again, the heat is transferred from the cylinder walls and other parts of the cylinder by convection as well as conduction. The liquid becomes heated in its passage through the jackets, and it is in turn cooled by means of air cooled radiator system. So the heat from the liquid in turn is transferred to air, hence it is called as an indirect cooling system, as we are going to cool the liquid by using air circulating through the radiator. So the heat will be removed from the components by using liquid, and again that liquid is cooled by using air, and that liquid is again recirculated through the system. That's why it is called as a indirect cooling system. Okay, the different types of cooling system as mentioned on the screen are direct or non-return system, thermosiphon system, forced circulation cooling system, evaporative cooling system and pressure cooling system. We are going to go through these systems one by one. But before that, firstly, we are going to go through this figure, which shows us how the water jackets are provided around the different components of the internal combustion engine. So as we see here, these are the water jackets provided here. The dotted lines shown are nothing but it is the water present in the jacket for representation purpose. So this is nothing but this is the cylinder block, or we can say cylinder body. So piston is reciprocating inside the cylinder, and here this is nothing but it is the cylinder head. Again, water ports, water jackets are provided near the wall ports. Here we can see these are the water jackets. So this is nothing but water transport port. So this port is used to transfer water from either from cylinder block to cylinder head or from cylinder head to cylinder block, so that we can recirculate the water through the jackets, so that it can remove the heat from these different components of the engine. So it is the liquid cooling system, and different types we will discuss. The first point is, or rather the first type is direct system, or it is also called as a non-return system. This system is useful for large installations where the plenty of water is available. The water from the storage tank is directly supplied through an inlet valve to the engine cooling water jackets, and this water is not reused, it is directly simply discharged to the body. So we are not going to recirculate the water in this system, so it is called as a non-return system. We are going to take out the water from the tank, we are going to cool the engine by using that water, and that water is released. So it is one kind of a liquid cooling system. The next is second system, that is thermosiphon system. Figure shows the principle of thermosiphon system. Here there are two tanks, tank A and tank B are provided, as we can see here. So heat is provided to tank A, where the liquid in the tank will absorb that heat and it will get heated, temperature will be increased. So obviously we know that there will be density difference. As it gets heated, density will decrease and it will start moving through this pipe to the other tank, tank B, and it is replaced by the relatively cold water present in tank B, and it will come in the tank A. So thus the water is circulated by just convection currents. This is the working principle of thermosiphon system. And here, if we are going to use this principle to our IC engines, we can say the tank A can be represented as the water jackets present in this IC engine, or rather around the block and head of the cylinder. And this tank B can be represented, or rather we can represent a radiator of the system with using this tank B. So now water jacket, the heat of the body of engine will be absorbed by the water present in the water jackets, it will get heated and it will travel through the pipes to the radiators. Again, in the radiator, the water is cooled by the air moving through the radiator, and that relatively cold water is again recirculated to the water jackets in the engine. By such use of convection currents, this circulation of liquid will take place inside the system and the engine is cooled. So in order to ensure that the coolest water is always made available in to the cylinder jackets, the water jackets are located at lower level than the radiator. So the, you can see here also the two levels of the two tanks are different. The tank A is relatively at the lower position when compared to the tank B, so that the convection current of the water will take place regularly. The main advantage of this system are its simplicity and automatic circulation of the water. Obviously here it is the just thermosiphon effect, or we can say the convection current flow, so that we can don't need here a pump for the circulation of water. So the system will become simpler and automatic circulation of the water will take place. The main limitation of the system is its inability to meet the requirement of large flow of rate of water, particularly at the high output engines. So if the high output engines cannot be incorporated with this system, as the flow of water is restricted because of the convection current only. The next system which we are going to study is the third one, that is forced circulation cooling system. The principle of forced circulation cooling system is in front of you, and again one cross section of the automobile is also there, where the cooling system is shown. In this system, it is used in large number of automobiles like cars, buses, heavy trucks. Okay. Here, the flow of water from radiator to the water jacket is by convection assisted by the pump. In water, or the water is circulated through the jackets around the parts of the engine to be cooled and kept in motion by centrifugal pump, which is driven by the engine. The water is passed through the radiator, where it is cooled by air drawn through the radiator by a fan or by air draft due to the forward motion of the vehicle. The thermostat is used to control the water temperature required for cooling. The system consists of a radiator, fan, water pump and a thermostat. So here all the components of system are shown. This is the radiator, this is the fan, thermostat is used to control the temperature, this is the circulating pump, a centrifugal pump, and this is the engine. So the pump will circulate the water through the engine. The water coming out of the engine will be provided to the radiator. Here it will be cooled by the air stream which is flowing through the radiator. There are two methods for drawing the air. First one is the forward motion of the vehicle. It will directly take the air flow, and again the fan is provided. So this thermostat will control the running of this fan. If the temperature is very hot, the fan is switched on by this thermostat, and at the lower temperatures the fan will be off. Again, at starting of the engine, the flow to the radiator will be restricted so that the water is circulated around only to get the required temperature of the different components of the engine. Okay, this cross section again shows that the fan and the pump are again connected through pulley to the driving shaft. Mainly the power required for this driving of this pump and fan is taken from the crankshaft or camshaft by using pulley drive or chain drive. Okay. So basically this system is used in majority of the automobiles. The next is evaporative cooling system. This system is predominantly used in stationary engines. In this, the engine will be cooled because of the evaporation of the water in the cylinder jackets into steam. Here the advantage is taken from the high latent heat of vaporization of water by allowing it to evaporate in the cylinder jackets. If the steam is formed at the pressure above the atmospheric temperature, will be above normal permissible temperatures. Okay, here the condenser is used in this system. It may be either air cooled or water cooled. So we can see in this figure we are having an engine which is liquid cooled system. A represents a centrifugal pump which circulates the liquid through the engine body. Then B is the overhead tank where the liquid is stored. We have to use separate condenser to condense the steam here, which is represented by C. So working will be like this: as this pump circulates the water through this jackets of the engine, that water coming out of the engine will be collected, rather the water here will get converted to steam because of the absorption of heat, and that steam is collected here in the tank B. As you can see here, the steam is present, which is again circulated through the condenser. Here the condenser is water cooled condenser, as we are going to observe the system of evaporative cooling with water cooled condenser. So again there is a water flow here. This separate circuit for the water flow is again provided, and here the steam which is coming from the engine is condensed in this condenser, and it is again due to gravity the water will flow through this tank B. Then from the tank B again this pipe D is connected to the pump, which will again circulate the water to the engine. Thus this evaporative cooling system works. The next system is pressure cooling system. Here the system is same as like forced circulation cooling system, only the difference is here in order to make the system or rather the radiator compact, that is to reduce the size of the radiator, it is proposed to seal the cooling system from the atmosphere and allow certain amount of pressure to build up in the system. So that the advantage may be taken the fact that the temperature of boiling point of water increases as the pressure increases. In pressure cooling system, moderate pressures say up to 2 bar are commonly used. Figure shows a pressure cooling system here. Here there are two valves are used in the cap, that is safety valve and vacuum valve. So what happens? When the coolant is cold, both the valves are shut, but at the engine, as the engine warms up, the coolant temperature rises until it reaches a certain preset value corresponding to the desired pressure when the safety valve opens. But if the coolant temperature falls during the engine operation, the valve will close again until the temperature again rises to equivalent pressure value. When the engine is switched off and the coolant cools down, vacuum begins to form in the cooling system. But when the internal pressure falls below the atmospheric, the vacuum valve is open by the higher side outside pressure and the cooling system will attain the atmospheric pressure. So thus this pressure cooling system works. So we can reduce the size of the radiator used in the cooling system. So these are different types of liquid cooling system. Let's go to the advantages and disadvantages of this liquid cooling system. So basic advantages we can go through are, first one is the compact design. As the liquid cooling system will be efficient when we are going to compare it with the air cooling system, we can use the compact design, or rather the system will be compact for liquid cooling system. Then the next advantage is the even cooling of all the parts. As water jackets are provided around each component of the engine, the cooling of all the parts will be even. And the third advantage is engine location is not the concern. That it means that as we are going to use a liquid cooling system, we can locate the engine in front of the vehicle as well as at the back side of the vehicle. Only the position of the radiator will be important. So we can place the radiator in front of the engine so that air coming at the front side of the vehicle can go through the radiator so that liquid is cooled. That is main advantage of this system. If the air cooled engine is there, we have to keep it in front of the vehicle only so that air stream can pass over the engine. The major disadvantages are, first one is the power consumption by pump affects the output, as the centrifugal pump and radiator fan are again coupled to the output shaft, that is crankshaft. The power generated by the engine will be, some amount of power will be consumed by the pump and the fan. So the total output power gets affected. The next one is high cost. Obviously, we have to use different components here, like centrifugal pump is there, radiator is there, cooling fan is there. So incorporating all these components will surely is going to increase the cost. The third one is the maintenance of the system. Again, the system is a little complex when compared to air cooling system. So the maintenance will be again problem. So this was regarding the liquid cooling systems. Or rather we can call it as an indirect cooling system. And the next one is air cooled system, or we can call it as also direct cooling system. Okay, in air cooled system, a current of air is made to flow past the outside of the cylinder barrel, outer surface areas of which has been considerably increased by providing cooling fins. This method will increase the rate of cooling. As we see in the figure, the cooling fins are provided around the cylinder block as well as the cylinder head so that air stream can flow through these fins. And the fins means it is the enlarged surface area so that convection heat transfer can be increased. This method is mainly applicable to the engines in motorcycles, small cars, airplanes, and the combat tanks, where the motion of vehicle gives a good velocity to cool the engine. In bigger units, a circulating fan is also used. In addition to these engines, air cooling is also used in some small stationary engines. Okay, so basically this is for very small engines where the airstream can cool these engines, and major common example which we all know is the two-wheeler engines, that is motorcycle engines, which are provided with fins and those are air cooled. Okay, so the advantages and disadvantages of air cooling system, let's go one by one. Advantages: first one, that is simpler design. Obviously we need not to have any external components like liquid circulating pump or fluid circulating pump, a radiator, etc. So the design will be simpler. Only we have to provide a number of fins around the cylinder block and cylinder body and head. Less weight. When we are going to compare this with the power output of the liquid cooling system, engine with liquid cooling system and engine with air cooling system, power to weight ratio will be more for air cooled systems. So the required weight is less, and again no external components like radiator and pump are required in this system. So again the cost will be reduced. That is the advantage. The disadvantages can be like it will be applied only to small and medium engines, large engines cannot be air cooled. Then the cooling is not uniform, as in case of liquid cooling systems we saw that because of the circulation or water jackets provided around each and every component in this engine, the cooling will be uniform. Here the cooling will be non-uniform because air stream is going to pass through the fins, and because of that there is non-uniform cooling. Then the third one is higher working temperatures. So we cannot control the temperature here, we have to rely on the air temperature, temperature of the air stream only. So that cannot be controlled. As in liquid cooling system, we can use a thermostat to control the temperature of the cooling liquid. So these are the some advantages and disadvantages of air cooling system. So basically a quick recap, we have seen different what is the need of the cooling system in IC engines, and then the characteristic of an efficient cooling system, different types of cooling systems, that is basically two main types, liquid cooling system and air cooling system. Again, liquid cooling system can have different types like direct system, thermosiphon system, forced circulation system, evaporative cooling system and pressure cooling system. And the next type is air cooling system. Then we have gone through the advantages and disadvantages of both liquid cooling system as well as air cooling system. I hope you will understand all these points. Thank you.